We welcome you here today to worship and pray as we lift up his name with our praise. Leaving all our cares outside and humbling our hearts, we stand together on this Sabbath day.
Good morning, happy Sabbath, everyone. I'm so happy to be worshiping with you guys today. And as we get ready to celebrate in communion, communion isn't just about Jesus dying. We always focus on just the blood and his body we gave. But communion is really about the fact that God made a way. He made a way for you to live again. He made a way for you to not have to die for your sins. He made a way for you to get out of your house this morning. So let's remember that as we worship today, okay? You by surprise, you got this figured out. You're watching us in you. You made a way.
When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you.
Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
You move mountains. You call the walls to fall with your power. You form miracles. There is nothing that's impossible.
power. You perform miracles. There is nothing that's impossible. And we're standing here only because you wait. You move mountains. You cause walls to fall with your power. You perform miracles. There is nothing that's impossible. And we're standing here only because you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way. 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 Don't know how, but you did it. Made a way. Don't know how, but you did it. Made a way. Don't know how, but you did it. Made a way. Don't know how, but you did it. Made a way.
When our backs were against the wall, and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Glory to God, glory to God. How many of you know that he is a way maker? He is a way maker, and that's the reason why we're all here today. That's the reason I'm standing here today, is because I serve a God who is a way maker, and he is a mountain mover. Somebody ought to say amen, put it in the chat. Somebody ought to say way maker, go ahead and put it in the chat. That's the God that we serve today, and I'm so glad about it. Today is such a special day. Here at the Decatur Seventh-day Adventist Church, we are coming back from our camp meeting experience, a mountaintop experience, where we experienced the power, the grace, and the goodness of God all over again. And we're so thankful that every year, and even though we're still in this pandemic season, yet at the same time, the doors of the church has never been closed. We have continued in worship and continuing to praise the God who keeps making a way. We're also celebrating communion today. So we're just looking forward to that experience. Most of you are still at home, and so this is going to be a virtual experience today. We have been blessed to keep celebrating communion, and Jesus told us in his word that we ought to do it until he comes, and he looks forward to that day when he's going to drink that wine anew with us in the earth made new. And I'm looking forward to that time. What about you? I know you're not here, but you can put it in the chat. Just say amen. Just let us know that you are with us this afternoon. Well, we're going to jump right into the word of God for today. Again, I want to thank our musicians, Sister Peace Presley and Brother Rashad Presley, and Brother Greg Ropen, Brother Sister Kelsey. We praise God for you all, your ministry today. I'm going to invite you to take your Bibles with you, or your iPads, your iPhones, whatever it is that God has blessed you with right now, and just go with me to the book of Hebrews. Let's go together to the book of Hebrews, chapter 10 and verses 19 through 25. Again, Hebrews chapter 10 and verses 19 through 25. I'm going to read in your presence from the English Standard Version. And here's what the word of God says. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is through his flesh. And since we have a great high priest, since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near. Or if you were in church today, I say, let's draw near. Let's draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Hebrews again 10 verses 19 through 25. I'm going to focus really on verse 20, where it says, by a new and living way. And that's our topic for today, a new and living way. Would you pray with me this afternoon? Loving God, we thank you for being a way maker. We thank you, God, for opening the doors of access for us so that we have a new and living way into your presence. God, speak right now. We pray that every distraction will cease, that even while we are watching online, most of us, God, that we will focus in and lean into this message that you have for us today. May nobody miss what you desire to say. May we, God, come away from this experience with an encounter with you that is real and that is transforming, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Over the last several weeks, we have been speaking on the theme of transition. We've said to you that our world is in transition. Our church is in transition. Our families are in transitions. Transition is the process or a period of changing from one state or condition to another, according to the Oxford Online Dictionary. Transition means change. That's the key word. It signifies that there is something we are leaving behind and something new that we're moving towards, something new we're leaning into. Jesus Christ, I would like to declare to you today, was the greatest transitional figure of all time. Did you hear me? Jesus was the greatest transitional figure. He was the greatest change agent of all time. His life, death, resurrection, and heavenly ministry calls upon us to leave some things behind and lean into something new. Somebody put it in the chat right now. Lean into something new. This is the reason that Jesus came to this earth, to move us from one state and stage to another. He came to move us from symbol to substance, from antitype to type, from shadow to reality, from ritual to relationship, from old covenant to new covenant, from darkness into light, from error into truth, from death to life. Jesus was all about transition. Oh, somebody ought to say amen right now. That's the point we're making today. You've got to get this, because if you and I don't get it, if you and I don't grasp it, we're going to miss the message. We're going to miss the bus, like the ancient people of God did. Well, the Bible says that he came unto his own, and his own received him not. They rejected him because he did not fit in with their preconceived notions and preconceived ideas and preconceived opinions. He did not go along with the status quo. His teachings rocked their boat and turned over their proverbial apple carts. There are people today who turn away from the preaching of the gospel, not because it lacks truth, but simply because the gospel challenges us to change in radical new ways. It challenges us to surrender preconceived notions and long-held beliefs and ideas that may have served us well at one time, but now they're no longer relevant or needed. You see, even though many of the Jews had accepted Jesus, watch this now, even though many of the Jews had accepted Jesus, they were still very conflicted. They had not yet grasped the significance of Jesus' ministry and sacrifice. And so they did not know what in the world to do with the ceremonial laws. The greatest theological issue that the early church wrestled with, the issue that kept plaguing them, was over the issue of these ceremonial laws. The laws pertaining to the sanctuary in the wilderness, laws concerning sacrifice and offering and the priestly ministry. The Jerusalem council had settled it for the Gentiles, but the Jewish Christians felt like they still had to do these things. They still had to keep the feast days and the ceremonies, the Passover and the wave sheep offering and all these things. They still had to keep these rituals because that was a part of their heritage. It was a part of who they were. It was a part of their Jewish heritage. But what about us today? As black Christians or white Christians or Latino Christians or Asian Christians or however you identify yourself, does your culture get in the way of the gospel? Come on now. There are people who will not give up a slave diet. Yes, I said it. A slave diet of fat back and chitterlings and pork chops. Even though it's killing us. We're dying from heart disease and hypertension and diabetes at a higher rate than the rest of the population. And it's directly relatable to our diet. But we refuse because of how we were raised. It's a part of our culture. Now, I'm not here to condemn anybody's culture, not my own culture or anybody's culture, not your culture or my culture. You might not have known any better. And the Bible tells us that in times of ignorance, God winks. Meaning that he doesn't judge you when you don't know any better. But when the truth comes, when the light of knowledge is turned on in your life, then it's time to make a change. Somebody ought to put in the chat, make a change. See, the book of Hebrews was written to early Jewish Christians to help them make a change. These Christians had been raised so that their lives revolved around the sanctuary services with all of its rituals and offerings and sacrifices and priestly ministrations. And Hebrews was written to help them understand that all of that had one purpose, and it was to prepare them and to prepare the world for the one who would come and fulfill it all. The one who would come and satisfy the debt, pay the price that sin had incurred. Oh, my friends, that one was none other than Jesus, the Son of the living God, who was better than the angels of glory, greater than Moses. He had a better sacrifice because the blood of bulls and goats could never take away sin. You had to keep on killing them. You see, the blood of bulls and goats only reminded you of sin, but it could not take away the sin. But only one, the Lamb of God, Jesus, who never sinned, he only needed to die one time for sin. Why? Because he was the Lamb of God that takes away our sin. When Jesus died one time, it was done. From the cross, he cried, "It is finished. The debt has been satisfied. The price has been paid." So that we can sing today, "Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, but oh, he washed it. He washed me. He washed you white as snow." He did it and it was done. Somebody ought to say hallelujah. Somebody ought to put in the chat right now, "Done, paid for, canceled, satisfied." And so the writer of Hebrews says, therefore, whenever you see that word in the word of God, therefore, or in discussion and conversation, you need to always ask, why is it or what is it there for? It is there because the writer of Hebrews is about to draw up his final conclusions as he's coming to the end of his dissertation, this book of Hebrews. And so he says to them, "Therefore, brethren," or brothers and sisters, "since we have confidence since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is through his flesh. What is he saying? Well, what he is saying is that Jesus, through his death and sacrifice, has made a way. Oh, somebody ought to say made a way. They sang about it earlier today. He is a way maker. He has given us access into the very presence of God. Did you hear what I just said? See. Let me go back a bit here. The old Hebrew sanctuary, the believer had access to the outer court. And that was as far as you went. It was as far as you could go. You were persona non grata in the rest of the sanctuary. The outer court was where, watch this now, where the lamb was killed. The outer court was where the sacrifice was made. But then there was a second compartment of the sanctuary called the holy place. And in this portion of the sanctuary premise or the sanctuary campus, you had the table of showbread. Mm-hmm. You had the seven-branched candlestick, they call the menorah. And then you had the altar of incense, which was placed right before the curtain or the veil that separated or that gave entrance to the most holy place, the last compartment. It was in the most holy place. The next compartment, the third compartment, that the ark was kept. And above that ark, there was the mercy seat and the Shekinah glory of representing the glory, the presence of God. Now the high priest, the priest went into the holy place every day. But none of them could enter the most holy place. The only one who was allowed into that most holy place, the very inner sanctum, was the high priest himself. And that once a year on the Day of Atonement, nobody else ever went into that area of the sanctuary at the point of death. And even on the Day of Atonement, the people stood in fear and apprehension and held their breath until the high priest had completed his work on their behalf. And when he was done and he came forth alive, they knew that all was well, and they could then rejoice. But watch this now. The writer of Hebrews now says, you and I have access to the holiest, the very presence of the God of the universe, and we have access not with fear and trepidation, but with confidence, because Jesus has made a way. Oh, somebody ought to put it in the chat again. He's made a way. Jesus has opened the door. Jesus has provided access. Do you understand, child of God, what an awesome and precious privilege that is? See, most of us do not have access to the mayor of the city of Atlanta. You can't just walk up to the mayor. You can't just walk into Mayor Bottoms' office. You just don't have that kind of access. Only a few people around her has that kind of access. You don't have access to the governor of Georgia or wherever state you live in, or worse yet, to the president of these United States of America. If you try to force your way into their presence, you know what they're going to do. They're going to take you somewhere where they put you in white. You know what I'm talking about. Or where you wear an orange suit, either one. The way that some of us adore and talk about our team or some personality, you would think we have access, but we don't. We don't have access. But in Jesus, we have access to the presence of God. Matthew tells us that when Jesus died on the cross that Friday afternoon, that the veil of the temple, that separating curtain between the holy place and the most holy place, the historian Josephus says that this curtain was about 60 feet high and, watch this now, 4 inches thick, and that 2 horses tied to either side of the veil could not pull it apart. That veil that was 4 inches thick was 2 torn into. Suddenly, that which had been hidden for centuries was now open wide because Jesus made a way, a new and living way. Now, the word new means fresh, something that never was before. And that word living speaks to the fact that he did not stay dead, but he got up from the grave. And Hebrews says that now he ever lives to make intercession for you and for me. He is the fulfillment of the sanctuary on earth. He is our sacrifice, and at the same time, he is also our high priest. He is our access to God. He is our way in. Paul says we are sitting in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Jesus opened the door. He is our way in. A friend of mine told me a story some time ago that he was a student, one of our HBCUs called Oakwood University in Huntsville, Alabama. And while there, he had the privilege of working with and for the president of the college, Dr. Delbert Bacon. One day, the president invited him to attend a function together. And when they got to the function, my friend says he got so distracted and caught up in what was going on, meeting the girls and seeing his friends and all of that good stuff, that he left the president's side for a while. And then he knew that the function was about to start, and he needed to get in, and he began to make his way to the gate. But when he got there, they could not find his name anywhere on the list. And they said to him, "You cannot get in here." And then he said, "Well, I am actually here with the president of Oakwood University." And they went back and searched through that list again, and they found the president's name, and right under the president's name was his name, and he was able to get in because of a relationship that he had with the president. How many of you know that there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved? For there is salvation in no other name than in the name of Jesus. Somebody ought to say amen out there. There's salvation in his name. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the door. He is the gate. He's the access point. He's the only way into the presence of God Almighty. The question today is, do you know him? Do you have a personal relationship with Jesus? The one who has provided for you and for me a new and a living way into the presence of the great God of the universe. See, my friends, this was never about ritual. It was always about relationship. Therefore, the writer says, we have boldness, we have confidence to enter the presence of God. Oh, I wish I had time today. I'll have to have this as a part two in all of what that means. But let me say this. He does go on to say, therefore, again, let us draw near. In other words, he's saying, because you have this access, and because you can come to God with this confidence, without fear and trepidation, because there is one who understands, there is one who sympathizes, there is one who has endured your pains, your struggles, and borne your sins, and he is there representing you. He's there in your flesh, in the presence of the Almighty. You can come with confidence. You can come boldly. You have a high privilege, and how do you make use of that? Draw near. He says, let us draw near. In other words, you don't need to hang back. You don't need to stay in the outer court. Are you with me? You don't need to stay on the margins. You can come on in. Oh, somebody ought to say hallelujah. You can come on in. I believe today that the Christian church is full of folk who have come to the brazen altar, which is the cross, which represents the cross. And they have seen the sacrifice and embraced the sacrifice of Jesus. And then they've gone on to the laver, that basin right outside, still in the outer court, where you can get washed up through baptism. And perchance many of us have even ventured into the inner sanctuary to pray or to partake of the bread of life or to study the word of God and receive more light from that lampstand, which is the
light of the word of God. And I would say that many of us have gone, we spent time in prayer, but we still have not drawn near. See, you can study the word of God and still not get close to God if you study it in the wrong way. Jesus said at one time, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, but they are they which testify of me. See, God is inviting us to draw near. He's inviting us to come close. He's inviting us to intimacy. No, I need to back that up a minute. He's not just inviting us, he's commanding us. It is written in the imperative, not a wish, not merely a suggestion, but he says, let us draw near. Come near. Come near. This nearness, this intimacy is something that we must experience each and every day of our lives. You see, yesterday's visit within the veil, if indeed we spend time there with him, is not sufficient for today's challenges. It is not enough, church, to be confident of his death for us. It is not enough to be confident of our sanctification, to fill our heads with knowledge of these things. It is not enough to fulfill an obligation of simply entering the church and going through the rites of worship and adoration to say the proper prayers and drop the proper offering into the plate from time to time, or now as we're giving online and simply say amen at the proper points in the message. God has, by the tearing of his son's flesh, he has opened the way into his very blessed presence for you and for me. It is in his presence, my friends, that we must come, that we're invited to come and commanded to come, to spend time with him and him alone, where we push aside the cares and the concerns of the world and we shut it out. And we get into that secret place, that most holy place, and spend time with him and us alone. We need to leave the world behind with its sin and its lust, its grief and defeat, its despair and death, and enjoy his presence and give him the enjoyment of our presence. And we are commanded to draw near. My friends, when we refuse, when we disobey his command to draw near, we imperil our own souls, and we miss the whole point of everything. What God wants is a relationship with us. What he desires is intimacy with us. And everything else serves that one purpose. The question is, what will hold you from drawing near? What keeps you from drawing near? You said, Pastor, why do I need to do this? Because it is only in his presence that transformation happens. Ah, Paul puts it this way. He says it is by beholding that we are changed from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. It is only in his presence that we find joy. For the Bible says, in his presence there is fullness of joy. It is in his presence that we find peace. It is in his presence that we find power. It is in his presence that we find victory. It is in his presence that we have provision and everything that we stand in need of. And when you visit somebody, and you stand outside and you knock on the door, what is the purpose? When they open the door and they say to you, come on in. Isn't that the purpose? That you go on in? And that you don't stand on the foyer or in the hallway, but you go on in where there's laughter, where there's fellowship, where there is communion, where there is relationship. And so today the message is simple. God says, I've made a way. I've provided access for you. And that access means you can come on in. You can get close because I've made a new and a living way. Right now, we're going to prepare for transition to our service here at Decatur. But before we do, there's somebody you're watching today And you've been living a life, whether as a Christian or not, of quiet frustration. Maybe you're stuck in something, going around in circles, caught up in a cycle. And the message today is you can get out of that cycle. You can get out of that negative pattern. You can get out of that habit if you would draw near. If you would lean into
those
Jesus, if you are willing to let go of what's in the past and to trust your future with him, you might have been doing some things the same way for a long time, and there's some things we need to unlearn. And I was talking to somebody just yesterday who's going through a tough time. And they said to me, Pastor, I believe I'm coming to the conclusion that God has allowed me to be in this space and he's leaving me in this space is because he's trying to teach me some things. And so my question is, God, not when am I going to get out of this situation, but what do you want me to get out of it? You have me in it for a purpose and for a reason. I'm going to stay here until I learn what it is you have for me to learn. Because it's nothing for you to bring me out of it. He's a God who knows how and when to transition us. He's a God who is your way out. Would you trust him? Would you say, yes, Lord, I'm going to give it all to you right now. I'm just choosing you, God. I want you to have your way in my life today and tomorrow and for always. Here's what you do. Because we're waiting. We're waiting. God is waiting. He loves you. And this is what you do. You type the word decision right now to 619 Decatur. That's 619-332-2887. Just go ahead. Type that right now. The word decision. And we're waiting to receive you, to pray with you, to put our arms around you right now. Maybe you're looking for a church home. And yes, though these doors are closed to our regular worship, we're still open. We're still ministering to our community. We're still loving each other and fellowshipping with one another. Because at the end of the day, that's what church is all about. It's about God's people caring and loving and sharing. And so you're looking to change your membership. Maybe you're moving from another city and you're moving into the metropolitan Atlanta area. And you're saying, Pastor Ross, I want to be a member of the Decatur Church family. Then go ahead and type the word member to 619 Decatur. Do it right now, and we will respond. We will acknowledge your request. I want to close out right now with a word of prayer. And for those of you who wish to participate in this communion experience together, our church members, we're going to invite you to stay on for just a few more minutes. Let's pray. God, we thank you for being to us, for opening to us anew and living way. We thank you, God, for overcoming sin in the flesh, being willing to come and bear our flesh, come in our shoes, Lord, our human shoes, and conquer that which has defeated us, and then appropriating your victory on our behalf. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for getting up from that grave. We rejoice in that. That you ever live now to make intercession for us, to plead the merits of your sacrifice on the cross. Thank you for caring for us. Thank you for being on our side. Thank you for representing us in the courts of glory. And thank you for the hope that offers to each of us today. We receive it. We accept you, God. We surrender our lives to you once again to be changed by you, to do whatever you want to do in us, with us, and through us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And God, for that man or woman right now who is accepting you, I pray, Father, that you will strengthen them, that you will bring them out of any indecision and uncertainty and help them right now to follow through with their decision for you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Again, brothers and sisters, we're going to ask you to just, are we going to prepare to transition right now into our communion service? As you know, this is that special time where we
take time to reflect and we take time to remember the sacrifice, what God did to redeem us from the curse of sin, that he broke that curse, and all that he went through in those last few hours of his life. And we remember that just before he went to the cross, and just before he actually broke bread with the disciples, he washed their feet. He stooped low. Yes, the King of Glory, the Creator God, the Son of God, stooped and he washed their feet. And he said to them, just as I've done to you, I want you to do the same to each other. And so it is in keeping with that command, that word from Jesus, that we wash each other's feet. And so you've already prepared the basin, the water, the bowl, whatever you have in your home, in your place. And we're going to give you that opportunity right now to wash each other's feet. And then we're going to set the timer for 12 minutes.